मैडम फॉर योर वैल्यूएबल गाइडेंस। नमस्ते एंड वेरी एनर्जेटिक गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। माई सेल्फ प्रोफेसर विक्रांत पारेक्षा। आई एम इंट्रोड्यूसिंग टुडे टुडेज वेबिनार स्पीकर प्रोफेसर वीना शेनॉय। शेनॉय मैडम हैज 12 ईयर्स ऑफ रिच एक्सपीरियंस इन इंडस्ट्री एंड एकेडमिक्स। शी इज एन असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर एट ISBR बिजनेस स्कूल बैंगलोर। She is pursuing her PhD from the National Institute of Technology, Karnataka. She has completed her MCom from the Savitribai Phule Pune University with gold medal and stood the first rank in the Savitribai Phule Pune University merit list. As Principal Madam already told that she is our college alumni and we are very proud on her. She has also completed her MBA and postgraduate diploma in industrial relations and personal management. She has presented and published more than 32 papers in national and international conferences as well as in journals. She has co-authored book with Dr. Chetan Bajaj and Nandini Bajaj. The book name Introduction to Rural Marketing for the New Age International Publisher. She is highly commended paper. She got a highly commended paper award for paper presented at IIM Convergence 2016 for the paper. She also got best research paper award for a paper presented at MP Birla Institute of Management Bangalore. Also, she got best research paper award for the paper presented at IISc Bangalore and Best Research Paper Award for the paper presented at WE School, Mumbai. So from this introduction, already we know that she has a very huge and large experience in the area of how to write research paper. I welcome you, madam, on behalf of Maharshi Karve Stri Shikshan Samstha, Sri Siddhivinayak Mahila Mahavidyalaya, and request you kindly start your session. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Professor Vikrant, for the introduction. I request organizer to stop presenting your share so I can share my PPT. Thank you. Give me 1 minute. I hope PPT is visible. One S or one organizer can intimate the same, then I can proceed with the session.
Yes, ma'am, they are visible.
Okay. It's visible, right?
Yeah, they're visible.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome you all to the national webinar on how to write research paper. So before I start, I request all of you to mute your audio and put off your video, so that there will be no disturbance when I'll take the session. So if you have any difficulties in understanding, once I start, you can put your questions in the you can drop your questions in the chat. So at the end of the session, last 10 minutes, I will be addressing that questions. Due to the time frame, what we have initially discussed, in case if I'm not able to address all the questions, I will entertain that in the Telegram. So today's, before we start, I welcome all the participants and I thank the Siddhivinayak College for this opportunity. Let me start with my webinar, the outline of the webinar. Okay, today we are going to discuss, we have segmented entire outline of our webinar into three parts. that is introduction to research, terminologies in research, because there are various terminologies in research, understanding today's key importance, what is problem statement, how you have to look for problem statement, and when you go for selecting your topic and the title, what are the scenarios and what background you should have, then what will be the purpose of your study, what context you have to do the study, what is proposition and what is hypothesis. And when you go for publishing your article, it can be in UGC CARE, it can be in Scopus, it can be ABDC listed journals, it can be Social Science Index journals or Web of Science, how you have to identify the journal. Because most of the cases we go wrong in identifying the journal. So I will just focus on how you will choose your journal when it comes to the different kinds of paper. Post which the last session would be the last 45 minutes I will be discussing on structure of research paper. So we'll start with the session. So what is research? Research is giving solution to the research questions. So research questions will arrive from your research topic. You will narrow down your topic, then you will come to the specific title. Based on that title, you will see what perspectives you will be doing your research on, what context you're doing, what methodology you will adapt, so that it will give solution to your research question. So when we talk about research, giving solution to the research question, there are various approaches. There are different approaches in the research. What are the scenarios? Qualitative, quantitative, and the mixed approach. What is qualitative approach? Qualitative in a form of words, where we give more importance to the in-depth interview, rich description of your data. We go for quantitative when you will go for a survey method, you will apply statistical tool and you will prove your hypothesis, or that is more about survey based, quantitative based method. Then we will go for mixed research approach, that is combination of qualitative and quantitative. Whenever you will go for experimental study, whenever you will go for exploratory research, you can go for the combination method. So most of the cases, we have different approaches in the research, qualitative in a form of words, quantitative in a form of quantitative method to prove, and we go for combination method. Now, different way to find results, because we have various statistical, for example, you can go for in the qualitative, you can go for content analysis, you can go for thematic analysis, you can go for ethnographical study, you can go for various aspects where you would like to know the in-depth information about that topic. When you're doing something new, it is very important you can go for a qualitative study, understand the base of it, then you can go for the quantitative study. So there are different ways to find your result. So any result what you're projecting, it is based on your research question. So when we talk about research question, we have general research question and investigation research question. General research questions will be like, what is that topic all about? How you're operationalizing your definition. For example, if you're doing a research on COVID-19, so what exactly in COVID-19? What is the operational definition? You will be understanding students' perception towards COVID-19. Then how you're conceptualizing your theory, that is very important. On what context you're doing and what perspective you're doing. So that is all about different way of finding your result. So once you're clear with your research question and investigation question, whether you would like to investigate, for example, in the Indian scenario, we give more importance to the research objectives than research question. If you want to publish papers, or when you will understand from the global perspective, they will give much importance to the research questions than the research objectives. So research questions will be reflected in a form of research objectives. So retrievers look up existing knowledge. Retrievers look up is nothing but your literature review. So literature review is done to understand the gap. Until or unless you are not understand, you're not having the base knowledge or the background information about your study, it is very difficult for you to look up in the future scenario. If you have any clarity about what other researchers have done, so that you can show the novelty in your study and you can prove how your study is different from them in terms of qualitative or in terms of quantitative method, then why we have to go for research? So research, creation of new knowledge, you can develop something new which has been already, which has been not explored by anybody. It can be adding to the existing knowledge. every time it is not possible, you have to invent something new. You have to go for the new knowledge. You're going for the creation of new knowledge. So what we can go for? We can go for adding to the existing knowledge. You can take a topic which has already explored. What additional add-on you can give as a form of moderator or a mediator when it comes to the variables. So adding to the existing knowledge, what is your contribution to that study? There are studies which has been already proved the relationship between two variables. So what is your contribution to that? What is uniqueness in your research? That happens. You have to cultivate the habit of reading when you get into the research. So more and more you read, the more perspectives you will get, more understanding you will get, and more wide option. So always it is, when you copy from one person, it is called as plagiarism. When you copy from another person, it is called as research. Because
Madam, can I disturb you in between?
Yes, ma'am.
Please F5, click F5 so that your PPTs are full screen visible. Please.
Yes, ma'am. Because some of the slide, because of the time, I will be not. So I will get to know to see my slides also, what I will be doing in the next.
Okay.
These PPTs will be shared with the participants.
Okay.
So,
no problem.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.
So when you go for adding to the existing knowledge, so as I said, when you go for plag, if you're copying from one person, it is called as plag. Because when you're copying from 100%, it is called as research. Because you're understanding 100 perspective, you're understanding 100 context, you're understanding what kind of contribution they have given to the theory or body of the knowledge, what phenomena they have done the concept. So it is like a broad understanding about that topic. So understanding that, what is your contribution? And the third scenario is validating the existing body of knowledge. Always there are already proved relationship. So you will be applying, you are showing a gap, considering analysis gap, considering methodological gap. Okay, they have used some different sampling techniques. You will be using some different sampling techniques. So that will be a gap. So validating the existing body of knowledge with the different tools, different methods, different analysis. So how exactly what you have to do, you should have a clarity before you start with your research topic or the title. So good evidences come from well-designed research. I would quote here, according to the professor from Stanford University, CRISPR, he said, research is like cooking. So it is up to you when you start cooking what you have to cook. I have cooked something which I loved. I love sweets, so I've started cooking what I love. It can be gajar ka halwa, it can be gulab jamun, so it can be ice cream, what I have started. The same thing when you start something new, when you're writing your first paper. So there are various scenarios how to choose your topic. So when you start cooking, you should know what you're cooking and you should know what ingredients you're going to mix. So you should know what resources are required to do your research. So at the end, what if I'm doing gulab jamun, at the end it should be gulab jamun, it should not become gulab syrup or it should not become payasam. So same thing, the projection. So initially the planning, research is all about advanced planning and research is evidence-based. Anything you say, if I'm smiling, I have to justify why I'm smiling. If I'm crying, I have to justify why I'm crying. Research is evidence-based. So here, according to that professor, research is like cooking. So I teach my students the 40 hours of research methodology relating every component of your ingredients of cooking related with research. It can be literature review, it can be sampling, it can be everything. So same thing, when you're cooking, whether you're cooking for 5-star level or if you're cooking at the 3-star level or for the people who are there at home. So same thing, we have different providers. Whether you're publishing your paper in the Social Science Index, Web of Science, ABDC listed, C category, B category, A or A star journals, or UGC care list journals. So same thing, your contribution, your idea, your planning, your research design, your methodology, everything should go hand to hand. Everything what you do in research is based on your research questions. Research questions are based on your identification of your problem. There should be some kind of concern and issues. Okay, when you talk about IT, what is a concern? Attrition. When you discuss about healthcare, what is a concern? Survey Q model. When you discuss about educational institution, what is a student engagement? So engagement is an issue. Either it can be industry or here. It can be employee engagement. It can be customer engagement. It can be student engagement. So every field engagement is a challenge. So there is a new terminology in the cognitive aspects. So that is employee experience, customer experience. So we have behavioral science. So behavioral finance. So where you would like to see the scenarios pre-COVID and post-COVID. So what perspective you're doing your research, whose problem you're going to solve, that is your population. So without understanding all this, so first you have to create a base. You should do a lot of reading. You have to cultivate the habit of reading. With that, you have to give a strong foundation or theoretical foundation for your research. Then you can proceed with all the topics what we are going to discuss today. So now we are coming to how to choose your topic or title for the research. As I said, when you start cooking, you have to cook something which you love, or you have to cook for someone whom you love. So then your contribution, your dedication, your commitment towards that work is very good. So when I have started what I love, the domain. It can be HR, marketing, finance. It is a broad area. When you talk about finance, we have more than 30,000 plus subtopics in finance. What exactly in that? What are the issues and concerns? Okay, you have problem with working capital management, whether we can run the business with negative working capital management, you would like to see in particular industry. Okay, you have to apply some kind of this disaster strategy, because during this COVID, there is a lot of layoff from the HR perspective. There is a lot of termination. So people are going for the survival strategy before they leave. Before every year in the month of April, May, you can see people will switch on to the job. Now they don't want to switch on. So what scenarios, what perspective, what context you're doing, that should have a clarity. So how you will narrow down? Research is all about you are having broad understanding about that topic. When it comes to your top title or specific, you should be very focused. You should have depth knowledge. It happens only when you have a broad knowledge, then you will narrow down your topic. So for example, one of my friend, her area of interest is cars. So she loved car. As I said, when you choose the topic, it can be with your personal experience. It can be something which you love. It can be through brainstorming. It can be with the discussion with your research supervisor. You can choose a topic which is very relevant, like COVID-19. You want to do something on COVID-19. There is a revolution in the education industry. So we have not thought. I'm addressing now 700 plus participants through digital mode. So I would like to write a paper on that. On what context? Who will be my sample? What is my population? Whose problem I'm going to solve? So that clarity you should have when you proceed. So my topic is car. How I will narrow down my topic. So when I narrow down my topic in car, what extra, what new, what novelty, what is something relevant to the present scenario I can come up with? So self-driving car. Okay, when you talk about self-driving car, what exactly in that? How I will frame my research question? Okay, I will talk about somebody who is doing self-driving car from the marketing perspective, or I will say self-driving car is very useful when I go for the office from the HR perspective, from the computation, or I will see self-driving cars from my work-life balance perspective, or self-driving car I would like to compare with the normal people who will drive. So here the research question is how a self-driving car is better than, or you're comparing with the normal the car driven by people. Okay. So you are doing a comparison here. So when you're doing a comparison here, in your research design, you can go for comparative scale you're comparing to, or you can see the benefits and the strength and weakness of the both the aspect, and you can give your justification. So everything is based on your research question. So when you set your research question, you should have a broad understanding about that topic. You will narrow down what exactly you will be doing in that. Then you will come to your particular research question, what you want to do. Research question is how you're going to demonstrate in your entire research project and research paper. At the end of your research paper, in the conclusion, you should able to justify, yes, this is how I'm going to solve this problem. This was my question when I started my research, and this is a solution for my research. Any approaches you can go for, qualitative, quantitative, or the mixed, we have discussed in the previous slide. So any approaches you can go for, but at the end of your research paper, you should able to justify why Okay. If you're going for self-driving cars is better, you have to give a reason. If you're going for driven by people, that is better. Okay. If you're going for an argumental discussion, why? Everything should be justified because research is evidence-based. There is one more example for a clarity I've taken here. Choosing the topic and developing your research question. So, one of my close friends, she is very much into music. So, she relate music with stress. She relate music with happiness. She relate music with engagement. She relate music whenever she will get any scolding from her mother-in-law, she will sing a song so that she will calm down. So there are various scenarios. You can do research in social science. Nobody is stopping. If you love PUBG, you can write something on PUBG, how it will be. But how it will create a market and what kind of information it will give to the policymaker in terms of decision making. For example, if you're doing something on COVID-19 on the education sector, in the future, if any kind of this kind of disaster will come, being an educationalist, being a policymaker, what kind of changes or what kind of strategy I can have in advance so that I can avoid in the future. So that clarity you should have. So we are following certain process and this is an example. So my interest area is music. So see, research is not something which is rocket science. It is your mindset and it is your interest. If you have interest towards something, start doing something what you love. So your involvement will be very high. Once you start cooking, then anything you can cook. So once you start your research, then anything, nobody will stop. When I can do, anybody can do. That is a concept what I wanted to give. I have to create a hope in the researchers that you can do wonders if you go in a proper flow. So choose your topic. Your topic is music. Narrow down your topic. Now, I want to do something music relating with teenagers. Okay, so still you will narrow down understanding the time. Okay, what is the time frame? How many sample I will choose? Which place I'm going to do my research? Who will be my population? So again, I will narrow down. I will think I will be doing a research on music plus teenagers. The teenagers age group between 13 to 15. Who will be, which location I will be focusing? US. Next, I will move to the next scenario before what I would like. Okay, now I know I want to do a research on music. When you take any topic, you should know whether you would like to relate input and output. Input is your independent variable. Output is your dependent variable. This is X, this is your Y. Whether you would like to develop any kind of relationship, or you have to do a just, you're just finding out what are the attributes. When you listen to music, how it will create happiness, music and happiness, that is your dependent, music and teenagers. So here, what exactly we want to do? Okay, now you've got two construct here or two variables here. What exactly? What is the difference between variables and construct? Variables which are measured directly, like income. Construct is something which cannot be measured directly or observed directly. So whenever you're doing any study on social psychology, behavioral science, like perception, attitude, emotions, likes and dislikes, feelings, attitude, that all come under construct because which cannot be measured. If I'm asking you what you like, so different perspectives will come in this webinar. So I am not measuring which cannot be measured directly, that is construct. So you have to understand difference between variable and construct. So whether you are relating the construct or whether you are relating to variable, what is your input, what is your output? So music and teenage with the age group of 13 to 15 and those who are staying in United States, that will be your population now. Now still I will narrow down in that what exactly I would like to do. So how this US teenagers age group between 13 to 15 impacting their music, listening to the music and relating with their schoolwork. So when they will listen to music, how whether they can complete their schoolwork or they can do simultaneously together. So just you have some scenario or concerns or dissonance in your mind. That is your problem or statement. For that, you would like to give a solution. So here you are clear with your research question. Same thing when you take any topic, it is very important from a broad area you have to narrow down and you should be very focused and specific when you reach to your research question. Same based on your research question, you can develop your research objective. Always research objective will start with active verb to understand, to know, to evaluate, to to evaluate the impact of relationship between listening music and completing your schoolwork. So when you are having impact word, then you can think, you can apply regression model in your analysis. When you want to see the relationship, you can apply R, that is a correlation. So every step in the research, what you do, it can be your thesis, it can be your research paper, everything is related. It is a process based. So you cannot write in your abstract, you have written, you are following qualitative research. In your research design, you are showing you have done a survey method. Then there is a mismatch. So people may not entertain you when you are going for a very good publication. So everything should go hand in hand. So every chapter should have linkage with other chapter. Every structure of the paper, what you write, it should have linkage with other element what we are discussing now. Now, steps for developing research questions, same thing what I have discussed. Pick up your topic, narrow down your topic, think what exactly you want to do, what perspective you want to do, who is your population, whose problem you're going to solve, and after solving the problem, what kind of information you're going to give it to the policymaker. And if you want to modify your research question based on lot of understanding with your literature review, how you will focus your research question. So this process you have to do. Now, identification of journal, one of the important topic. As I said, research is like cooking. When you cook, you should know you're cooking at 5-star level, 3-star level, or for your people or for your relatives, or what kind of dish you're doing, that is up to you. Same thing, if you're planning to send your paper to ABDC listed journal, that is Australian Business Dean Council journals, in that we have C category, B, A and A star, and we have Scopus Index journal, we have UGC Care Index, UGC Care listed journals. So now when you identify your journal, so before you start writing your research article, it is very, very important you should have a clear picture about for whom you're writing, because every journal will have their own author guidelines. They will have the word count, 6,000, 10,000, 12,000. They will mention whether you have to follow a UK spelling or US, that is organization, S or Z. And they will mention what kind of referencing you have to follow, that is Harvard referencing or APA format referencing. There is not much difference between Harvard and APA. In Harvard, only journal name you will write in Italy. Other things are same. So you have to understand, because before you start writing, when you know what you're preparing. So if you're preparing a gobi manchuri, at the end, it should be gobi manchuri. So advanced planning is required. At the end, you will write your abstract. When you, most of the cases, what people will do, they will write entire article. At the end, they will write an abstract. That is a wrong method. First, you have to write your detailed abstract and your research design. You have to keep it in mind what exactly you will be doing. Then you can go for writing your article. Whenever you will go for collaboration with foreign authors or collaborators, they will ask for detailed extract, plus they will ask for your methodology and design part, what exactly you're going to project. Once they will get a clear picture about that, then they will proceed for understanding. So here, when you go for identification of the journal, the first step would be, what is your topic? What is your title? What is a problem of statement? As I said, every sector will have some or the other concern or the issue. So what is the issue, what you want to solve? For example, in the urban area now, rural area, people are having network related issues. So they may not connect. So how we will reach out to such students in this COVID situation? So that can be a problem. So somebody would like to write a paper on that, you can write. So now, because of COVID, there is a scenario has changed. As I said, behavioral finance, people's perception has changed. People are giving more importance to the health. So their lifestyle has been changed. So their investment in the health policies and the term policies has been increased. So people are giving more importance to the health. Lot of behavioral changes happen. So if you're writing a research article on that, you can keep what is your concern, issues and dissonance in that particular sector. Then that you can take as your research problem. Then you can go for narrowing down. Then come to your focused, what is your research question. Once you're clear with research question, what research design you will be, that we will discuss entire flow, what and all things will cover under research design, what you have to follow. Once you have clear idea about this, you can go for looking for research identification of the journal. So you have to see whether you are writing a paper for UGC CareList journal. Then you can go to UGC CareList and you can write, you can see and you can choose your topic. When you choose, it is very important. We have open access journals and we have subscribed journals, that is paid journals and unpaid journals. When we go for paid journals, what happens? You have to see the publisher. Who is a publisher? For example, Emerald, Emerald Insight, Taylor and Francis, Whaley, InterScience, and Sage Publication, Science Direct. These are the very good, the well-known publishers. So, or Elsevier, you have to publish your paper under open access under this publisher. You can publish because that charges what they are taking for a open access. It is more of for your paper visibility because they have to follow certain protocol for the visibility of your paper, so it will reach out to people. That is open access. So there are some journals like Predictory Publication. They will ask you to pay 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 rupees. Within 2 days, 3 days, they will publish your article. So you should know what are this Predictory Publication, how you can identify this Predictory Publication. So I have jotted down. See, I am not blaming anyone because being a researcher, being a faculty, we know the difficulties of the faculties. You will have a pressure for your employment. Okay, you have to find a job. So you have to show 2 to 3 papers in UGC or in Scopus. Or you have a pressure that you are completing your PhD. The criteria to Scopus indexed publication should happen. Or you have a scenario where NAC visit is there, NBA visit is there. Before that, you have to show that 50 articles published in this year. So with this lot, what people will think, okay, we will pay and we will publish. So when you publish, you should know certain aspects. You have to keep it in mind how you have to look for the journals. That is, when you talk about Predictory, you will pay immediately, they will publish. They will not have ISS number. What is International Standard Serial Number? They will not have DOI, that is Digital Object Indicator. Digital Object Indicator is a unique number given to your paper or the research article. So most of the paper, even in the UGC, which has DOI, you can go for publication in that. And the scope of the journal is very wide. If you are going for any of the renowned publishers whom I've just given, like Emerald Insight, Taylor and Francis, Whaley, Springer, or anything, so what they will do, their scope of the journal is very specific. If you want to do something on corporate strategy, they will have a particular journal which will be focusing on corporate strategy. If your topic is on corporate strategy, so if you are sending your article to that particular journal, make sure you download some current paper which has been published. For example, you are sending your paper now, make sure this month issue, okay, it can be quarterly issue, half yearly issue, once in a year, you have to see. So download some base paper of that particular journal, see the standard, how it is. This I'm not telling for predictory journals. When you go for a good publisher, usually you should understand the scope of the journal. Otherwise, within 48 hours, when you send it to a good journal, they will reject your paper because at front, they will reject your paper because it is not matching the scope of the journal. So this predictory journals will have a wide scope. They will entertain, okay, in social science, they entertain healthcare paper. Also in healthcare, they will entertain IT related paper. So it is a mixed masala. So it is not focused because they have a wide scope. Anything we entertain, we will make a special issue. In special issue, 400 papers should be there and 3,000 rupees will charge. So you know what priority they have here. So next one, no clarity about article processing fees. When you go for a predictory publication, they will not mention. So then they will send, okay, your immediately today you will send, your paper has been accepted, pay the 3,000, 4,000, in the next 3 days it will be published. So these and all things you have to see. Again, when you're going for UGC Care Index journals, or we have a subscribed journals where you're not paying anything, it will take a peer review, it will take a process, but for that also you can send your paper. Exactly, it is everything depending upon you. What you want to do, you should have a clarity, you should have your priority. UGC, Scopus, ABDC, how long it will take. So if you go for a Springer, they will give a clear range. So if you go to a Springer, you have journal suggester. So you can write your title of the paper, you can paste your extract. Once you paste, you can go for the find journal suggester. So So it will suggest what are the journals where you can communicate your paper. So when you see that, and they will, in that journal, in the Springer, that is the advantage, they will write a range. It will take, for review process, it will take 12 weeks. After that, it will go to the second review. Then this is a process. So you have to wait for 8 to 12 months for your paper. So there are scenarios. So they will give a time frame. So you will understand this, this long it will take. So if you have some pressure from your management, if you have a lot of scenarios for the employment, for your promotion, you need publication, then you can see how you will. It is up to you. What is your priority? What you want to do? So then you will have more clarity about it. That is on a journal suggester from the Springer. When you go for Elsevier, we have journal finder. You write your topic. You write your means topic. You have to paste. You can Google it and you can see journal finder from Elsevier. So you will write your title. After that, you will paste your abstract. Then you will go for search journal. Then all the relating to your topic, relating to your title, relating to your abstract, what are the different journals, understanding the scope of your study, so where you can communicate your paper. So you will get a clear picture where you can communicate. You can see in that whether it is half yearly, whether it is ABDC, A category. So your paper is of, I'll tell you, if you are tapping UGC, Scopus, ABDC, what are the novelty or what contribution they will look in your paper? That is what we discuss. Before that, always you have to see, when you talk about predictory publication, we will have poor online presence. They will not have a very great online presence, you can understand. Journal is not well indexed. See, when you are sending, I am not having any objection sending your paper in the UGC care list. Again, it is up to your choice. So when you send, see whether it is indexed in Google Scholar, whether it is indexed in EBSCO or JGate or ProQuest. So at least if it is indexed in Google Scholar, you can go for it. So journal, you have to always, when you communicate, you have to see indexing of that journal. Then you have to see officials of the journals are using normal Gmail account. They are not having any G Suite. So Gmail ID they are using. So you will understand there is some problem you have to identify. This is for predictory publication. As I said, when you go for identification of the journal, in the Elsevier, you can go for journal finder. In the Springer, you will have journal suggester. You can Google it and you can see. And you can give your title and your abstract, then you can find the relevant. In that, you see, based on your skill set, what you have planned, where it will suit, that you are the best person to decide and choose where it will fit in. Based on your entire dish, what level you have made your dish, then you can choose whom you will serve. Okay. So next, now, very important. Good research paper. Now we are coming to the structure. Before that, this aspects you have to keep it in mind. Good research paper should cover all these elements. What you're doing, clarity. Why you're doing, for whom you're doing, whose problem you're solving, what decisions you're giving to the policymaker, what information you're giving, what kind of impact it will create in the decision-making process. How you're doing, what are the sources? Okay, what sampling techniques you're doing, whether you're using qualitative, quantitative method, what you're using, what method of statistical tool you're using, when you're doing, it is any time frame, okay, 3 months, 4 months, 6 months, 1 year, 10 years, 20 years, so how long it will take. So whenever you take some project also, there is a time bound. So when you're doing, so that clarity you should have. So contribution of your study to the theory and practice, how you're contributing to the existing knowledge of existing body of knowledge. Why you're doing this study? If already we have 10,000 people have done study on that topic, what is your contribution in that study? How your study is different from them? That is very, very important. Now I'm going to the next slide. Okay. Now we have come to the real picture of our topic. As I have mentioned, the last 45 minutes, I will be discussing on structure and flow of research paper. So this is a common, you can go for Scopus, ABDC, UGC. Keep this format in your mind. So this 15 points should be there. It can be for your PhD thesis also. This is the format what you have to follow. Some state university, deemed university, central university, they have their own format. that you can follow, but it will be in this projection itself. One is, what is the title? We have discussed based on identification, based on your problem, based on your interest, based on the brainstorming, based on your personal experience. You want to do something, you can narrow down your topic to title. And there is a difference between topic and title. Topic is a broad area. Title is, you will narrow down, you know your research questions now when you think about title. Then the abstract, we'll discuss what and all element you have to cover in the abstract. Abstract is a summary of your entire research. So before you start writing your paper, your abstract should be ready. So there are certain attributes you have to cover in abstract. We'll discuss in the next slide. Keywords. Keywords plays very important role. Any researcher who will search for your paper, they will search with the help of keywords. So what keywords you will mention, the key construct of your title should be there in your keywords. So keywords plays very important role, because if you need citation for your paper, I would like to add, because 2-3 months before on COVID, I have written one paper on technology adaptations in the education industry, the faculty's experience, the initial 1 month, what kind of changes we have undergone. Because the day one when lockdown has started, we were switched to the online mode. In our college, we have done online examination. Everything is online. So what kind of perceptions and experience faculties have? I wanted to write an article. So I have written in the UGC CareList, because that is very relevant. I knew it has to come to the market very soon, because COPAs or it might take some time. So I wanted. So within 2 months, we got 5 citations for that paper, and we have 11,000 reads in the research gate. So you see the relevancy of your topic. What is a novelty? COVID-19. So if I would have given a title only technology adaption, people would have not entertained that, or they would have not read that paper. So COVID-19, there are scenarios. People will do a paper on COVID-19. They will search for the keywords COVID-19. So if I will put COVID-19 as my keyword, people who are doing research in that 100%, they will download my paper and they will read. So within 2.5 months, we got 5 citations. We are expecting more, because that is relevant. How it is creating the kind of attention, relevance, significance, or actionability, how it is actionable, reachable, all that will have impact in your title and your keywords. Introduction, we will discuss what are the introduction. See, I have attended one conference we had the editor from the Academy of Management. She had given one concept that I would like to share with my participant here. So her projection was, if you're asking, for example, I'm telling my papa, I need smart mobile phone. So in your research paper, you're writing, this topic is very important. This topic is very important. This topic is very, very important. This is essential. So you will write only that word. Why it is essential, nobody will address. So when I am asking my papa, I need smart mobile phone. So papa will tell, why you need smart mobile? Because he will have a different perception and the perspective about smart mobile phone. Girl is asking smart mobile phone. So when I'm asking when I sit for my breakfast, I tell my papa, I need smart mobile phone. If you would have got me a smart mobile phone, I would have complete my assignment. I would have got 20 marks in that. I could not complete my assignment because you have not got me smart mobile phone. Okay. Afternoon, when you sit for your lunch, she will tell papa, you have not got me smart mobile phone. Otherwise, I would have completed my class assignment. I missed my 5 marks. When you sit for the dinner, I will tell papa, I missed class quiz. I could not appear because I am not having smart mobile phone. So papa will understand the reality and the importance of that particular smart mobile. He will buy you the smart mobile. Same thing, the reviewer, the researchers, when you send your paper to entire journals, what emotions you will add on in your entire structure of your paper. That is very, very important. So Indians are known for giving emotions, but we lack when you write. So if you see the A-star publication, only few of us, we have A-star publication. Why not? So we can do wonders if we go in a proper channel, in a proper direction. So that habit we have to cultivate. So if you go for publishing in the Emerald Insight, every paragraph should be 280 words. in that 280 words, every 280 words, if you give a reason why this topic is important, why this title, why you're doing this study, what is the novelty, what is the contribution you're giving to the existing literature, or you're going for some new construct, which you are combining some construct from psychology and HR, like emotions with employee performance. You're taking some construct from the social psychology to marketing, because neuromarketing related topic. So then you will go for integrative literature review. So you're integrating two disciplines, then you will go for a literature review. Otherwise, we will go for systematic literature review, that is your theoretical background and hypothesis development. You have clarity. What is proposition and what is hypothesis? Proposition, so fifth point I'm discussing, theoretical background is more about your literature review. Literature review is done to understand the research gap. What is research gap? What other researchers have done? How your research is different from them? What new contribution you are giving to the existing literature? So you can refer John Criswell's book. In that, they have given how to go for literature mapping and literature gap. It's very good. He has explained the entire flow with various different charts. You can go for in-depth element of understanding the entire flow chart, or you can go for specified. So if time permits in the future, if I take any, I would like to take a session on literature mapping. So that is a theoretical background. That is more about your literature review, literature gap, what is novelty in your study, what kind of contribution you're giving to the existing literature. Then we will go for hypothesis. Before going for hypothesis development, hypothesis, you have to keep it in mind, you have opted for quantitative study, quantitative approach. When you go for a qualitative approach, you can go for a content analysis, you can go for a thematic analysis, or you can apply various tools like NBO for text analysis, you can apply NBO for word cloud or decision tree. So there are various things. Or if you want to do systematic review, you can apply CMA for meta-analysis. So there are various tools also that will come under data analysis, what tools you are using. So when you go for hypothesis, you are hypothesizing the relationship between two constructs. I have discussed what is construct. Construct which is not measured directly. When we use any behavioral science, or when you take psychology related topic like perception, attitude, feeling, emotions, where we cannot measure. If I'm asking, if I'll give a remote to male and female, the male preference will be news and sports, female preference will be serials and other. So there is a difference in their perception also. So same thing, you should have a clarity when you go for a construct, what is construct. So the relationship between two constructs is called as proposition. So in the proposition, you are not going proving that relationship statistically. You are just proving that relationship with the help of literature review. That is called as proposition. So when you go for proposition, you are developing this relationship based on your literature. What is hypothesis? Hypothesis is more about you're hypothesizing the statement, that is relationship between your independent and dependent variable, that is X and Y, is true or false. So for that also you have to develop the literature, but in hypothesis you are proving that with the help of statistical inferences or with the help of statistical tool. So it can be any kind of ANOVA, regression, not correlation is not a test. So how you will prove your hypothesis based on your research question. What methods? Methods are more about, method is blueprint of your research. Before you start doing your research, you should know what are the ingredients are required for cooking. When you start cooking, you will think, okay, for this dish, this ingredients is not there. That should not happen. So methods is more about the entire blueprint of your research, what approaches you're using, what research design, what is your population, we'll discuss in the next slide. So all that will come under methods. What are measures? Measures is more about whether you're going for adapting the scale or the measures which has been already there, or you will go for you're administrating your own questions. You are developing your the questionnaire, that is scale development. So in the measures, if you're taking measures, for example, you're doing a study on CERVIQ model, so or eCERVIQ model. So you will take Parashuram Zeithaml's eCERVIQ model. Based on that, you will create a base. So all the questionnaire what he has developed, you can take. Or if you're doing on the organization culture, the Cameron's questionnaire you will take. Or technology acceptance according to the Davis, what he has proposed, you will take. So there are some standard measures which has been already set. The validation of that has been done. So you can take that measures, you can adapt and modify according to your study. And the next method would be you will go for scale development. So there is a process for scale development, what you have to do. Data analysis is more about your what a statistical tool you're using in your study and what are the threshold value and what is your the background of your study, that is entire descriptive statistics will come under data analysis. Descriptive statistics before when you collect all your demographical factors, age, gender, qualification, income level, your mean, standard deviation, and your Cronbach alpha, KMO, sample adequacy test. If you're going for a SEM model, what are the process, what threshold you have to follow for model fit. Once model fit is there, then you will go for discriminant validity. So if you're going for data analysis, if you're going for PLS, so when your data is not normally distributed, or you will have a less sample size, people will go for PLSM. So otherwise, if you have huge data, you have normal distribution, you can go for AMOS, SPSS AMOS. So same thing, you can go for R, you can go for Python for your analysis. There are various tools. So what exactly? So in Indian scenario, we give more importance to the analysis. But most of the paper rejected in the top tier journal because of theoretical foundation. They lack strong theoretical base. So data analysis, because if you're clear with your perspective, the context, the clarity, the research question, everything, the background is very set, then the analysis part will take very less time. So most of the very good institutions, they will take 2 to 3 years for their conceptual framework, when they will make their conceptual framework based on their theory, based on the background, they give more importance to that. And data analysis and interpretation will be done within 5 to 6 months. So that kind of approach. Results, based on your data analysis, what are the results? Whether your hypothesis is supported or rejected, you will mention. Then you will write a discussion. Discussion, if it is supported, your hypothesis is supported, why it is supported. If it is not supported, why it is not supported. So then we will move to practical implication. Practical implication is more about your empirical, what you have projected in your conceptual framework, when you are empirically proved that, how, what kind of contribution it has given. So what kind of information you are giving to the managerial decision or to the policy maker. So in when we talk about implication, there are various kinds of implication: empirical implication, methodological implication, theoretical implication, conceptual implication. And you can refer John Summers' paper. In that he has given, there are 17 different kinds of contribution. If I can, I'll share post my session in the Telegram. So there are limitation and the scope of research. Limitation, what is your scope? If you're doing a sector, if you're doing your study in IT sector, that is your scope of your study. If I'm doing a study, a flexible working arrangement, a dark side of flexible working arrangement, then my study is confined to only a dark side of flexible working arrangement. I will be not focusing on the positive side of flexible working arrangement. So my study is designed, my reach is only negative working capital. So that will be my limitation. It can be methodological limitation, various your mediator, moderator, analysis, gap, what I've used, that can act, or demographics, what I've used, that can be my limitation. The same limitation will act as a gap for future researcher to pursue their future research. In the conclusion, you should be able to write answer to your research question, because when in the introduction, you will write your research questions, right? So you should be able to justify your research question at the end. And the core key findings and the managerial implication should be written in the conclusion. References, as I've mentioned, you can go for APA format and Harvard. Most of the journals will go for Harvard format and some will go for APA format. There is not much difference, as I said, in the Harvard format. Journal title in your references will come under italic and other aspects are same. Appendix, some of the journals, they will ask for your questionnaire, some of the tables which you cannot present in your entire article. So when you go for very good type publication, they want to see what exactly you have done. It should not mismatch what you've written in your abstract. It is a flow which continues from there. So introduction should continue in the theoretical framework. It is a flow. It is a process based. Research is process based. Okay, the next 20 minutes, I will be focusing on each sub point what we are discussed, how exactly or how you have to go about this, all the points. Okay, before going for points, it is very important. You should have a scenario. I said, whenever you do your research or when you choose your topic, you should know what novelty or what contribution it is giving to the existing. What you're doing, if it is already there, why you have to do a research? Why people will read your paper? Why they will accept for Scopus or ABDC? So there are some different criteria which you have to keep it in mind when you are tapping to the top tier or UGC listed or Scopus in that journal. So these are divided into five. This we have taken from this source which I have mentioned. You can go through that source from the research kit and you can get this paper also. So first one, there are some researchers, what they will do, they will replicate the same topic, same source, same thing. For example, motivation is leading to employee engagement. There are people, you will go to some publisher, you will download some paper and you will see, okay, you will see some paper which is shown the relationship between motivation and employee engagement. Or you will say you will see some paper where they have done a understanding about service quality measurement on behavioral intention. So what you will do, there is an attempt to replicate the same. You will take same topic, you will do a same study, everything is same. Okay, there might be some changes. Okay, what demographical you are using might be different. You will take a same reflection. So that is a one method where you will take some base paper, you will do your topic in a same study, same topic previously, which is already demonstrated. Second option you will have where you are predicting with the references of the past finding. For example, you will see same study, that is motivation leading to employee engagement. In that, they have used in the IT sector. In the second option, you will do in the automobile industry. You will show as a gap, IT was a gap because that was confined to IT and doing in automobile. So here you will project your gap like methodological gap. They have used sampling convenient, I am using purposive sampling. They have used ANOVA, I am using regression method based on my research question. So they have used some kind of the tool or the process. They have gone for the qualitative and the quantitative. We will be focusing only on the survey method. So method, what kind of how? It is like only a small change in terms of demographics. Demographics, the people whom they have collected data might be different. It will be different demographics. Only that slight difference you have in your study. First one is entirely reflecting. You are copying same, what is it? You are taking that same paper, same thing you are writing. First one, you are taking a paper from 2018 published. In 2020 you are publishing, you will add on 1, 2, 3 new literature to that of the present articles. Second one, you are making a slight change. You are changing a demographics, you are changing the analysis, you are changing the methodology, then you are showing that as a gap. Third option, building a new theory. So here in the third option, slight, you are making one new moderator or mediator. What is a moderator and mediator? I'll discuss in the next slide, that is conceptual framework. You are introducing one new moderator. Moderator is another independent variable which is not observed directly. So in order to give either to strengthen or weaken your independent and dependent variable relationship, we will go for moderator. What is a mediator? So mediator is something which will mediate the relationship between independent and dependent. Whenever you take moderator and mediator, it is not like word something you are taking. It is based on your theory, based on your literature. Lots of reading. You have to cultivate the habit of reading. You have taken a moderator, but in some studies it has shown as a mediator. Then how you are justifying why it is moderator? Everything you have to give a reason. You should have strong evidence to prove why it is moderator, why it is mediator, how it is influencing. Because if already relations has been proved in the previous literature, what is your contribution? What is your novelty? So building a new theory, third one would be you're adding one moderator, you're adding one mediator. The fourth one examines it previously unexplored relationship. There is something anew. For example, now I said COVID-19. So people, nobody has written COVID-19 paper pre-COVID-19 because they have not dreamt about that. So people will write, it is unexplored. So anything when you write on COVID-19, it will be considered as exploring something new. So in this 3 to 4 months, you can see there are various lots of paper, but still that area is understudied. There is a paucity of research where you can focus and you can see which and all area is not tapped, which and all concepts has been not covered. So there might be some concept which has been already covered. You can take some of the methodological gap. You can see the different context. You can see the different perspective. Then you can do your research. So examines which has been already, which has not already explored, which is understudied. So you are exploring that new study. That is the fourth aspect. The fifth one would be introducing a new construct. As I said, you can combine two disciplines, psychology, you can relate with marketing, psychology, you can relate with HR, and psychology, you can relate with behavioral science because a lot of behavioral change is happening due to COVID. So you're introducing a new construct and you're conceptualizing the definition you're giving. For example, one person is doing a research on motivation. He is focusing on monetary motivation. Another person is focusing on non-monetary motivation. Third person will be focusing on a motivation topic. In that, his conceptualization of motivation is leadership. The fourth person will be focusing on interpersonal relationship. That is important. Fifth person will be focusing on work autonomy. When you have a freedom, that is motivation. So every researcher has given their conceptualization. So when you're conceptualizing, when you're doing the interrelation, or when you're integrating two literatures, how you're conceptualizing, how you will contribute to the existing theory. So in the fifth option, that is when you're introducing a new construct, and that time you are giving high contribution to the theory. So if you are planning to write a paper for ABDC B and A category, you have to tap the last option, that is introduction to new construct. So if the first two, you can tap UGC listed journals, UGC care first two, replicate you can, because when you're starting, you can take a base paper and you can start. But if you're going for a Scopus, you can building a new theory, that is a third option. And fourth and fifth option, you can see for C category. Fourth option, you can look for C category or Scopus. And the fifth one, if you're tapping A and A star, there should be something new. There should be something high a contribution to your theory. Then only reviewer will accept your paper. This is in terms of taxonomy of theoretical contribution, because theoretical contribution is one of the major reason for rejection of paper. Because in Indian scenario, we give more importance to data analysis, what tools you're using, whether I'm using SEM, whether I'm using some other complicated tool. We are not giving much importance to the theory building and the base what you're creating. If you have a clear picture, because it can be your supervisors, they are not having much knowledge about statistics, but they are very strong when it comes to theory building. So that we are looking for being a researcher. If you want to be in a global scenario, they look for theory building, they look for your foundation, and your theoretical base should be very, very strong. I'm moving to the next slide. Okay. Now, how your title should be? We have discussed you have to narrow down from your topic to topic. You have to narrow down understanding what perspective, what context, why you're doing, what is your population, all that. You will narrow down based on your research question. So when you choose your title, when you write your title, again, see, for example, in my COVID paper, if I have not mentioned in the title COVID-19, if I would have mentioned only technology adaption, people would have thought only it is a technology adaption, she has done a research. If COVID-19 I have put, okay, there is a novelty, there is a new study. So that you should be very smart when you give your title. Some people, customer satisfaction, student satisfaction. There are thousands, lakhs or crores of paper on that topic. So what contribution? With your title only, they can understand the novelty or the contribution of the topic. So title plays very important role, and don't mention your scope in the title. Scope is sector. If I'm doing an IT sector, my study is confined to IT. Okay, my study is confined to IT. In research, there is no one size fit all. So every solution what you're giving, it is based on your research question. Your research question is based on your context, based on your research problem. So there one size will not fit all. If I'm doing a research in organization culture, in IT organization, that I cannot generalize for IT services. IT services, I cannot generalize for automobiles. So in the title, don't mention the scope. Okay, IT sector, healthcare, ITS, and you're mentioning hotel industry. Don't mention the scope. Scope is which sector you're doing. Scope will come under methodology. It should not come in title. Limit your title to 10 to 12 words. Some research articles, they will 10 to 12. Okay, if you're writing a thesis, they will admit up to 40. And some state university, they accept up to 16 also. That is internal application oriented. But when you go for title, limit your title to 10 to 12 words. Be precise. It is not like you're writing your entire topic in the title. You should mention your key construct in your title. Your key construct should be included. As I said, COVID, technology adoption, faculty experience, faculty involvement, student engagement, what you're doing. Okay, behavioral science is your topic. What exactly? Pre and post COVID, what are the changes? Or you're doing negative working capital, whether you can run the business with negative working capital. Or you want to see mergers and acquisition, how it has created influence on capital investment. So anything, and always go for interdisciplinary topic. Research should be multidisciplinary, it should be interdisciplinary. Don't restrict yourself, okay, I'm doing in HR, so I should know only HR. You can make a interdisciplinary topic that might entertain for the publication in the good journal. Next one, key construct must be included. I've explained what is construct. Do not limit the scope of the study with your title. Scope is IT sector. Okay, impact of employee motivation in the IT sector. You are giving the entire title. When we talk about title, we have declarative format sentence and we have interrogative. Declarative, we are declaring the entire. For example, in my study, I have written impact of employee performance on organizational effectiveness. So it is a declarative. Openly, I am declaring. There is interrogative statement where I will write, is there any difference between or impact of employee performance on organizational effectiveness? Then question mark will come. So here it is not necessary every time you should have colon in your title. You can use the question mark also, that is interrogative statement. And draft the title which will make a reader curious about your study. And your research novelty should be reflected. As I said, COVID-19. If I have not mentioned, people will not know that I have written a paper on COVID-19. What is a key term which will tap when people will look for your paper through Google Scholar or other portals or the Scopus Index journals? What they will do, either they will put your title or keywords. Your keywords should play a very important role because that may help you. People will read. It is a visibility. So people will read your article and they will cite, and then your H index will increase. Abstract. What should be included in the abstract? Very, very, very important. So most of the cases, because when you write abstract, you have to upload your abstract when you're writing ORCHID. ORCHID ID is like an Aadhaar card for all the researchers when you're sending your paper to the good journal. So if you log into ORCHID ID, it is like everything, all the reflections, which and all institutions you have worked and how many papers you have, everything will be identified through that. So here, the same thing when you go for an abstract is a summary of your entire research paper. So maximum limit of the abstract is 150. Some cases, if you're going for Emerald Insight, they have given 250 words. And some cases, if you're going for a conference paper to very IIT, IIM, IISc and all, they will ask for the descriptive abstract, where you have to mention your research question, research objective, detailed abstract. Or sometimes they will go for a special issue of a B-grade journal. So they will ask for a detailed abstract to understand what exactly you will be doing in the study. So what it should cover. So abstract should cover the first point in the abstract will start with purpose. If I'm asking to give your purpose or the entire study in one statement, you should be able to tell what is the purpose of your study. As I said, when your context is decided, your purpose also should be decided. The purpose will be to examine the impact of employee motivation on organizational effectiveness with the mediating effect of employee engagement. That will be my purpose. Once you write your purpose, then we will go for what is a research gap? What is a novelty in this study? You can write, I will be using Virum's theory to give a theoretical base, and that has been reflected. That is a contribution what I am giving to this theory. So anything, what is your, because I cannot justify, you are the master of your subject and master of your topic and title, because your perspective and your context will be different. So you are the best person to tell how it is a novelty, what contribution it is giving. So after purpose, you will write at least two lines about your contribution or your research gap or what kind of novelty your research carries. Then you will go for the methodology. Methodology, you will write whether you will use inductive reasoning or deductive reasoning. Inductive reasoning, when you go for a qualitative study, we will go for inductive reasoning. When you go for a quantitative study, we will go for deductive reasoning. Or what method of sample you have taken, what is your sampling size, and what is your sampling techniques, how you have collected your data, and entire what kind of a data analysis you will be doing, why you have opted for it. Because research is evidence-based. Anything you write, you have to write why. Okay, if you are saying my sample size is 500, why? Because according to the Nulli principle, last week I have taken one webinar where I have discussed various research design and sampling techniques. Some of them are attending today's webinar also. You can understand better today. So when we go for, there are some sampling theorem and sampling principle. So when you want to go for normal distribution of your data, you should have more number of samples. So if you are going for increasing accuracy of your sample, you need large number of samples. And always it is justified whenever you go for a sample, pick randomly. Otherwise, it might lead to biasness and that might reflect in as a sampling error. So all these terminologies we have discussed, and what sample size. There are some principles like Nulli principle. What is your questionnaire? If you have 50 questionnaire, 10 times of your questionnaire. That is only when you're taking a measures. Okay, measures means if you're adapting the scale, then you're modifying. In your adaption scale, you have 25 questions, 10 times of that. That will be 250 should be your sample size. When you go for the KMO, or you can go for sample adequacy test, through that you can decide on your sample size. So everything, what method you're opting, you have to justify. You can go for probability sampling, non-probability sampling, you have to justify why. That is on methodology part. So it is like brief. Inductive reasoning is enacted. This is a sample set. This is the techniques what we have used. And we have gone for the mixed approach where you have gone for qualitative and quantitative study. Quick, in two lines. Then you will write the findings. Most of the cases, people, the research scholar will say, why we have to write findings first only. When your context is clear, this is what, based on your purpose, this is your proving statistically. So you know what is your finding. What is your contribution? You are seeing the mediating effect of engagement between the independent and dependent variable. What exactly? What will be your finding of the study? In case finding is not supporting at the end, you can change the figures here in your abstract. So managerial implication, every time when you do a research, at the end we are giving solution to that research question, and it will reflect in how it will create an impact to the policy makers in decision making. As I said, when you're doing a paper on COVID-19, how from the faculty's perspective, how the educationalist, how the policymaker, the management take a call in the future. So difficulties faced by the faculty in this technology adaption. So what decision? So whom you're giving managing? For marketers you're giving, okay, in your context. Or you're giving for the vendors or distribution strategy. Based on your research question, for whose problem you're solving, that is your population, and for whom you're giving a decision, so that it, the flow will, the functioning, the growth strategy, the policy will happen, and they can look for various tactics and strategies for the upcoming future endeavors. Social implication, if your study has certain social implication, you're working on poverty, or you're working on social endeavors, or customer social responsibility topic, then you might have some social implication also in your topic that you can write as a, what is a social implication. Then implication for the future research and practices, you will write in one line. What is a scope? You will write here, that is your limitation. Or demographics, you have tapped only sample size of this, that can be your limitation. The future researchers can take this. or you can read the methodology what you've adapted, or the conceptualization what you've adapted in your study can act as a gap. So future researchers can explore that and take that as their research gap. So keywords, as I said, it is very important what you write in your keywords. People will search based on the keywords. So if it will reflect here and your paper will get more visibility. Introduction, what has to be written in the introduction? Introduction should cover need for your study. The first sentence when you start, it should reflect if you're showing input and output in your study. What is your input? What is your output? Why this input is required for the output? As I said, when I'm requesting, I need smart mobile phone with my papa, you have to give a reason why you need smart mobile phone. So here I've given various aspects what has to be indicated. So one is the need for your study. Why that study? Why you have taken that study? What is the novelty in that study? Before doing that, you have to write some statement on statement or identification of your problem and statement of your problem. Then how this study will give contribution to the existing theory of knowledge, and how this study will create any kind of change, challenge, or advance a scholar's understanding. At the end of introduction section, at the last, you have to tell why this study, whether it is understudy, whether it is a paucity of research, you have to mention the research gap. And at the end of introduction, you will write your research question and research objective. So once you write your research question and research objective, if you have decided on your conceptual framework, you can go about your conceptual framework. So before you write, you are clear with your context, you will read and you will develop your conceptual. So this takes long time. To take only to explain how to develop the conceptual framework, we need 15 hours. So this is based on your literature review, based on the understanding, lots of reading. So then you can cultivate, because I am not your topic, your title, your perspective, your context, your approaches, your solution. We don't know. So same topic, if 10 people are doing, I am okay with that, because their perspective will be different, their context will be different, their methodology will be different, their analysis will be different, their results will be different. So you should not get fear. So you can do same topic. Always people will have dissonance when people will take same topic. No. We should not feel dissonance for that. It is a different perspective they are looking for. Okay, literature part, sometimes it might be similar, because as you are going for a systematic literature review, I don't think so it will have any kind of impact. So theory and hypothesis. Theory is more about literature review. Based on the literature review, what you are projecting. So what is a mediator? Mediator which will show the mediating the relationship between independent and dependent. When you take mediator input variable, that is independent variable or dependent variable, everything is based on your literature. I cannot tell, okay, something you have projected as mediator, in some studies it is projected as a moderator. How you are conceptualizing your study, that you are the master, because that is your topic, that is your title. So same thing when you go for a moderator. What is a moderator? Moderator is another independent variable which is not observed directly, but it will have an influence. Either it will strengthen your relationship or weakens your relationship. So strengthens, okay, we can take that. If it is weakening, you can discard the moderator. So that you can prove. This is your conceptual framework. When this is proved statistically, it will become your model. That is model fit in SEM analysis, when you go for advanced analysis. This is how you will go for theory and hypothesis. So end of your introduction, you can give your conceptual framework. Then you can go for hypothesis development. So every hypothesis when you development, there is a lot of projection. So if your hypothesis is motivation, that is your X, is leading to engagement, Y, then you have to show the relationship in the literature which has been developed. So there are relationship which has been shown X to Y. So you have developed this hypothesis. So every relation, every hypothesis, what you're projecting, there should be a relationship in the literature. So when you go for integrative, I'll share one paper for integrative literature review. When you take two constructs from the different discipline, when you go for integrative, how your literature review should be, I'll share in the Telegram immediately post this webinar. So you can look into that, you will get a clarity. This is more about conceptual framework. Once you are clear with conceptual framework, so what and all has to be included. So here they have clearly mentioned when you go for a conceptual framework or when you go for a theoretical background, the strong, solid theoretical base is required. So you cannot say, okay, I have done, when I'm cooking, there are some dish or there are some ingredients when you put, it will make your dish very delicious. Oh, I forgot to look into that dish. Same thing, your literature review. So till you submit your thesis, till you submit your paper, when it will come for the review in this 1 year, there might be 4 or 5 papers which has been projected in a similar scenario. So you have to include that paper and update. So it is like you can add on ingredients, it will increase the deliciousness of your dish. So same thing, it will enhance the quality of your research paper. So what you should have a solid theoretical base. So morning before I start my session, I got rejection from one B grade. I have more experience in rejection than acceptance. So every rejection has given me some kind of learning. I'm taking it positively. It has increased my patience level. So how, what unique I can do? So I'm going, I think, okay, what better I can do? So don't think, okay, rejection is part of publication. So it is a part of learning. So we move to methods and measures. Give me 10 minutes. In 10 minutes, I will wind up the session. Methods and measures. Methods is more about research design. What is a blueprint of your research? Along with your abstract, your methodology part should be ready. When you go for a collaborators, don't go for your collaborator. Okay, you have to put your guide's name because she is a part. And so apart from that, when you go for a collaborators, the co-authors, see that they are unique in their contribution. One person is good in statistics, one person is good in literature mapping, one person is good in collection of data, and other person, if you're doing in IT sector, you have taken from corporate delegate who is from IT sector, he can give a more understanding about that particular sector. So go for the collaborator. What we do, we go for a collaborator who is our friend, who is our neighbor, who is our boss, so that we will get, okay, some kind of comfort zone will be there. It will be reflected in some other benefits. No, you have to choose your collaborators properly because that will have impact in your research. So research design is more about blueprint of your research. What has to be covered in the methods? One is approaches. We have discussed qualitative, quantitative, mixed. Qualitative in a form of words, you're going for in-depth interview, you're going for a schedule, you're going for observation. So a lot of market related. It need not necessary every time you have to go for a quantitative study and you have to go for hypothesis. It is based on your research question. So research question is clear, then you can choose what you want. Or you can go for a mixed approach. When you're going for exploratory study, experimental study, people will go for a qualitative, then they will move to quantitative. So you have to decide what is your research question. So because it is a flow, based on that, it will have impact here also. Data collection method. We will have primary data collection and secondary. Secondary, it is your literature review. It is a background information. It will clear standing on the shoulders of the gate. Where if you want to see the further, it is very important. You have to understand the base and understand the background. Then only you can say how your study is different from others. So your secondary data you will collect. And most of the cases, finance studies, what happens? You can go for ratio analysis, you will go fund flow and cash flow. You will take previous 3 years, 5 years, 6 years data of balance sheet. Then you will make a projection. You will apply a regression model. And if you're going for behavioral finance, people will go for primary data because that is related with behavior, psychology, cognitive aspects. So you can go for the primary data. So you are the best person to decide what exactly you want to do based on your research question. Now, important topic, who is a population? Population, whose problem you're going to solve? In my study, I'm going to solve the problem of marketer. I'm going to do a study where I want to see how many people are attending, perception of the people who are attending online webinars. Okay, that is, so what, who will be my population? All the faculties who are attending online webinar, okay, will be my population. What will be my target population? In that, I would be specifying the age group 40 to 60. I want to see, comparing millennials, whether Generation X is having more impact, whether the faculties who are age group 40 to 60, whether they are attending webinar or they are thinking, okay, that is not our cup of tea, let the millennials will take over. What? So I, from my population perception of people who are faculties who are taking online webinar attending, what will be my target population? In that I'm specifying the age group 40 to 60, because I would like to see what is their involvement when it comes to engagement. What is a sampling frame? Whom I can accessible, whom I can reach, that is sampling frame. So I can reach because I'm a MCOM student from Pune. I am basically from Mangalore and I am working in Bangalore. So I know three regions. So sampling frame, I will see to that. I will collect the faculties who are attending online webinar or national or any kind of webinar who are from this particular cities, because who are accessible to me. What will be my sample size? I will decide based on the sampling principle. What will be my sample unit? The faculty will be my sample unit. So you should clear in your study, it can be marketer can be your sample unit, student can be your sample unit, or vendors can be your sample unit, who customer can be your sample unit, whose problem you're solving, that is your population. Then you will understand who is your target population. Then you will come back to sampling frame, that is whom you can accessible based on your conveniency. Then you will go for sample size. Please mute your audio. So give me 6 to 7 minutes. I'll wind up. Then you can take over the session. Next one, sampling techniques. We have probability sampling and non-probability sampling. When you go for a probability sampling, you know your population. If I'm doing a case study in one company, I know how many people are there from the employee's perspective. If I'm doing a case study in one organization, I would like to develop a marketing strategy. So I would like to see from the vendor's perspective what kind of influence. So I know how many vendors are there. When you know your population, you will go for probability sampling. It is like a lottery method you will use and you will choose. What is non-probability sampling? You don't know your population. So I say how many of them are attending online webinar? I don't know count because it is not like census. Entire population is my sample. So what I will go for? I will go for non-probability. There are some techniques what you have to follow under probability and non-probability. Based on that, you will go for the best method, how it will be suitable to you. You can have a discussion with your research supervisor. If you have any confusion in terms of choosing your sampling techniques, you can consult me personally. I will be sharing my details at the end. So we can have a discussion. I will help you out. So measures. When we talk about measures, these are the scales which has been already. If you want to do a study on organizational commitment, Mayers and Allen scale. If you want to do a study on organization culture, we have Cameron's, we have Japanese concept. We have Davis technology adaption scale. E-service quality, we have Parashuram. So same thing when you take, there are already developed scale. So you can take that as a base and you can adapt based on the conceptualization, what you have done in your initial theory, based on your research question. So now you can adapt that measures and you can modify according to your study. That is your questionnaire measures. Next one, if you are not having any measures, you're going for something new, you're exploring a new construct, then you can go for scale development. Again, there is a process for scale development. You have to go for EFA, then once you get the EFA, then the process you will follow, the model fit, discriminant validity, convergent validity. First, before you set the question, you will go for phase validity, content validity. There is a process. We can have discussion on that. You can contact me personally. So that is scale development process implemented. So you have to decide whether you will go for measurement scale or whether you will go for scale development process. Now, data analysis, results and discussion. Data analysis is more about what tools you have used, statistical tools you have used to analyze the data. As I have informed, tools are not important. Your theoretical base are important. Any tool you can take, it will give you a result. After giving the result, the p-value you will get. If you are not able to give a projection or better discussion on that, why it is accepted or rejected, because tools will give you whether your hypothesis is supported or not supported. But you are the person, based on the theory, what you have learned, based on your literature, you have to give a projection. That is a logic you have to apply. That is how creative you are in terms of writing your discussion. So data analysis is tools. You can go for ANOVA, you can go for regression, you can go for multi-level regression, you can go for SEM model, structural equation modeling, you can go for PLS, you can go for qualitative study. There are various tools. Quantitative, there are tools. In the qualitative study, we will not go for proving the hypothesis. If you have a structured questionnaire, Then that structure questionnaire can be converted into factor. Then we can go for hypothesis development. Otherwise, in a qualitative research, we will not go for developing the hypothesis. Qualitative is done more about exploratory, learning new attributes to understand the factors, to understand the indicator, to understand the attribute, because that is an unexplored area. What are the results? Results is more about whether hypothesis is accepted, that is supported or not. If it is supported, you have to give a reason why it is supported. If it is not supported, why it is not supported, again, based on the theory. Next one, discussion based on hypothesis. Why it is supported, why it is not supported, with reason that will come under discussion. Now, implication, very, very important. As I said, you can refer John O. Summers' article for various contributions. If I can, I will share in the Telegram. There are various kinds of contribution. So most of the cases, you will write a practical contribution or empirical contribution and theoretical contribution in your study. But you should know there are different types of contribution. You can make a part of your theoretical contribution. Empirical contribution, you are testing your theoretical linkage, what you have developed in the conceptual framework, whether that is proving or not. Once it will prove or support it, then that will act as a model. It can be a moderator, it can be with the mediator. You have introduced moderator or mediator in the previous study, so that you are adding to the existing knowledge as a moderator or mediator, you can prove. Next one, managerial implication. What kind of implication it will have in terms of decision making? As I said, what kind of information you're giving, so it will reflect in, they can act as a tactics or the strategies for the future for your population. Population can be marketer, employees, employer. See, when you talk about HR, employees and employer. When you talk about marketing, marketer and the consumers. When you talk about the finance. So same thing, every field you will have, there are different participants. Whose problem you're solving, and what message you're giving, how it is reflected in the decision making. So that managerial implication, how it will enhance the decision making process in terms of your study. So if you're saying, okay, immediately they will not change their HR policies. If I'm saying, okay, flexible working arrangement is very important or it has to be implemented. So they will not immediately change their HR policy, but it will be implemented in the future when they will go for making some changes or add on, or it can be considered. Okay, theoretical contribution. What is your contribution to the theory? So in theoretical contribution, we can have a separate session where how there are various theories. For example, in my study, I'm including three theories. So theory support in your conceptual framework, how you're, when you're going for any new study, because research hawa mein nahi hota, usko evidence chahiye. So when you're giving the evidence, how you can give, when you're going and developing a new construct, theory will act as a support, theories. What theory will support your study, that you have to see, that is your contribution to the existing knowledge. Then conceptual contribution is more about what concepts you have developed, the construct, the definition. As I said, in my study, the conceptualization of motivation is monetary motivation. In Mr. X's study, conceptualization of motivation is non-monetary motivation. In your study, what is a conceptualization? That is your contribution. So in that contribution, if you are applying the regression model, what is the R square? Okay, if it is 0.72, okay, what are the other areas you have to focus? That will act as a research gap. The future researchers will take that as a research gap and they can pursue with their research. So methodological gap. Okay, previous they have used the different sampling method. You can go for a mixed sampling with combination of probability and non-probability. That is an advanced level. So it is based on your study, again based on your research question. You can have discussion with your research supervisor also when you go for a combination method. That is what is happening in the industry. So many people are going for the combination method. Now, limitation and scope for future research. So you're considering the scope of your study. As I said, IT sector, you cannot generalize IT result to entire population result. So scope can be your limitation. Your study's perspectives can be your limitation. The context, that is a methodology, your entire base can be your limitation because you're specifying only that segment. And demographic can be your limitation. The sample can be your limitation. The sector where you have done your study, automobile, service industry, education sector, IT, ITS, healthcare, financial services, that can be your limitation. what moderator and mediator you had adapted in your study that can be your limitation. So all this limitation will act as a gap for the future researchers. So that is future scope for the study. And conclusion, what you have to mention under conclusion. Conclusion should give answer to your research question. And it should also demonstrate some of the key findings and managerial implication for the policy making. So that short brief, you can write your conclusion. The references, very, very important. For example, some you have cited in the text, the body of the, and you have not cited in your references, then cross-check you have to do always. You have to make sure what citation you have given. When you give the citation, you have to write from where base has created. If I'm writing a paper on employee engagement, the concept of employee engagement was started by Kahn in the year 1990. So if I'm writing the concept of COVID-19, it has started in the year by the place Wuhan. So the base, the where the base has started, from there till now, what are the different context study has happened? What are the different scenario and methodology they have used? What are the decision, how it has reflected in their implication? So all this you have to. So when you go for a literature review, go for a systematic literature review that will give you a clear picture about your topic. So APA format, that is American Psychological Association, and we have Harvard style, most of the time we will use. MLA, that is Modern Language Association, is used in the literature. And we have footnote style, Chicago style, that is number referencing, and the footnote referencing, that is less used, but most of the cases we use APA and Harvard style.